First of all, let me thank the organizing committee for inviting us for to speak today. Today, my lecture about mastering the basic in OCT. We all know that we have a lot of OCT machines in the market, so we have to know mastering the basic of OCT, all OCT machines by knowing the basic knowledge of OCT. Today, I will speak about the raster scans, the line scans, and lastly, the OCT angiography, which is recently introduced about 1 year in the market. We all know that there was evolution in OCT. We started by the time domain, and then we went to the spectral domain, and recently we have the swept source with the fast and deep penetration through the retina. This is comparing the old machines with the new machines, with the Fourier domain or the spectral domain and the time domain, and we can see the acquisition time. We started at 512 A scans in 1.28 seconds. Then we moved to 1,224 scans in 0.04 seconds, which gave us an idea how to know the inner retinal layers, the outer retinal layers. We lose the artifacts, and we used to interpret the OCT better. Then came the swept source with a deeper penetration and longer wavelengths, and most important, the fastest scanning OCT. It's about 100,000 A scan per second, so it can overcome sometimes the saccadic movement and the artifacts in the pictures. This is a picture of swept source OCT where we can see the vitreous clearly. We can see the vitreous separation over here and at the disc. And then we can see the retinal layers very clearly. We can see the lesion, and we don't see shadowing below the lesion. So we can clearly see the choroid up to the sclera. So it segments the eye from the vitreous to the sclera in about 2.5 centimeters, 2,500 microns. Basically, we have to know the protocols on the machines we are working on. So we have radial scan, we have the raster scan, so we shouldn't miss any lesion, and we have vertical and horizontal raster scans. These are present in most of the machines. Then came the swept source with the 12 by 16 millimeter cube, which means you can scan the whole retina, 12 by 16 millimeter, in few seconds, and then you can revise this. And let me give you an example. This is a 12 by 16, and you can get a movie about that. Look at this movie, and I'm sorry. You can get it from here. It's not working because it's not my computer. Anyhow, you can scan the whole area, 12 by 16 millimeter, and you can see line by line, till reaching the macula, where you see the pathology, and you see what is underlying the pathology. What we need to know when we look at OCT, the basic knowledge, we have to know registration and reproducibility. Why? Because we are following up the patients nowadays, injections or follow-up operations by OCT. So we need to know if it is reproducible or not, and where is the registration. Second thing, we can have the cube acquisition and where the data we can get the cube from the cube. Then we look at the lines, where we see fine details of the retina, and then finally the OCTA, which will add a lot about the vascular integrity of the retina. This is the meaning of registration and how we can reproduce the image. We can see the cube, we can see the central line, and then the cube is center. And most of the machine has now tracker, which can track this later on, like this. If you follow up a patient like this with a macular edema, you can see how much the macular edema is increasing, not only by the false color-coded map, but also by numbers, and the registration is very important. Once you register to this, the machine automatically will follow up line by line and scan by scan. And this is another follow-up by line scanning, where you can see the difference between the edema, and it can subtract the presentation with the follow-up, so you can give you the amount of improvement or if the patient is getting worse. And this is very important nowadays because of the injections and follow-up. Another example of follow-up in the registration, you can see how much the edema looking at the line scan, but you need to know the quantification, how much the edema improved and how much is getting better, and you are sure you are in the same area, the same registration point. So you would know if the patient is improving or not, when to stop the injection or not. Another example, when you look at the scan, what are the artifacts sometimes we look? If this is an edema or elevation or thickening, how come it is not reflected on the map? Because sometimes the segmentation is wrong, and this is one of the basic knowledge you have to look at. Why it's segmentation is wrong? Because the machine could not delineate the retinal pigment epithelium line because of this hyperreflective tissue, so it starts to measure from here. So you have to correct this manually, and then you will get the right map. So always look at this, compare with the line scan, and see if you are right or wrong. Again, look at the line scan, and nowadays you have to segment. We used to teach in the retina 10 layers. Now it's about 16 layers. Why? Because we, with the help of OCT, we could delineate every layer. From the three layers of the choroid, the choreo scleral junction, and then we go, this is the most important, the outer retina, the layers of the outer retina. The retinal pigment epithelium, not followed by the IS, or there is another three layers in between, which the IZ and EZ zone, which we'll speak about in a minute, but look at this, six layers in the outer retina, then comes the other six layers, and then nerve fiber layer and the vitreous, and we can go beyond through the vitreous. Some of the machines now have the ability of automatic segmentation, but we all know if we have a pathology, this automatic segmentation will be wrong. We have to correct it manually, or we have to look at it. But the most important thing, to look at the outer retina, the four layers. We go through the Bruch's membrane, pigment epithelium, and then after the pigment epithelium, we have a very thin black zone, which the digitation, the pigment epithelium digitation, which engulfs the photoreceptor, then the IS-OS junction, then another hypo layer, and then the external limiting membrane. And look at this. This is a better picture taken by the spectralis OCT. We have to look mostly at the external limiting membrane and IS-OS. This is the ISOS, the junction. When it's disrupted, it has a very prognostic value, and this is the external limiting membrane. The ellipsoid zone, we call it the ISOS, and now the new nomenclature is the ellipsoid zone, which is easy. What is the clinical application for this? What we have to look at when we get an OCT? We should look at the choroid at the beginning, then the outer segment, then the inner segment, then the vitreous interface. We can get a lot of data from this, and we will go through in a clinical practice. The choroid, it's at three layers. Sometimes it's thick, sometimes it's thin, congested, choroidal inflammation, and choroidal tumors. This is a histopathology, a picture by the histopathology. We aimed through decades to look at the retina and to get this without invasive maneuver. And we can get this now with the swept source OCT. Look, this is a swept source OCT. We can see the large choroidal vessels, we can see the small choroidal vessels, and we can see the whole layers without any intervention. And we can see when the choroidal vessels are dilated, because now we have what we call pigment epitheliopathy due to the choroidal pathology. And we can see if the choroid is thickened in spite of what it is overlying, which is the dystrophy, and we all know that there is choroidal thickening now with most of the retinal dystrophies. In chronic CSC, what we learn by OCT, we know from the fluorescein there's a leaking point, destruction of the retinal pigment epithelium, but what is the data we get from the OCT? The hyperactivity. We always know that the choroid, the CSC or CSR or whatever they call it, chorioretinopathy, is due to choroidal pathology, and nowadays we can see where is the pathology. The dilated, congested choroidal vessels, which is the cause of leak in these cases. What else? We all know that after resolution of CSR or CSC, there's still something called flat irregular RP detachment, and OCT can delineate this, and OCT can show there is silent CNV in some of these cases, which we can get by OCT anyway. Even after complete resolution of CSC, there is still liability of recurrence because of the hyper or what we call dilatation and congestion of the choroidal vessels. Again, NVE overlying a focal area of choroidal thickening. This is what we call pigment epitheliopathy. Pachychoroid pigment epitheliopathy. Why pachychoroid? Because the choroid is thick, pushing the retinal pigment epithelium even in old age, not in young age, not in 30s, 40s, even in 60s. And we can get choroidal neovascularization on top of this. So this is the new nomenclature called pachychoroidopathy, pigment epitheliopathy, or pachychoroidopathy, choroidal neovascularis. We look in Harada disease, we have to look at the choroid because the pathology is in the choroid. Multifocal choroidal inflammatory lesion, pushing the retina, sensory detachment, and we used to follow up only the macular edema. But nowadays, we can follow up the choroidal thickening, and we can taper steroids depending on the choroidal thickening, not on the retina thickening. Looking at the outer layers, sometimes we get an RPE lesion like this and the patient is complaining and we don't see anything in the fluorescein or in the fundus picture. Why? Because we have an outer retinal wall. Why? What is the cause of this? Many causes, but mainly solar maculopathy or laser pointer burn. So we have to see clearly. So can we see clearly here? Yes, we can see the drusenoid RPE detachment. We can see the Bruch's membrane. We can delineate every layer in the retina. And then we can know when the choroidal neovascular membrane is coming in because of the hyperreflective things under the retinal pigment epithelium with overlying sensory detachment. Obviously, it's a choroidal, occult choroidal neovascular membrane. What we look also in the choroidal neovascular membrane, we have to look at the subretinal fluid, sub-RPE fluid, and intraretinal edema. And these are the parameters we are going to follow up the patient to know if he's responding to injection or not. Let's move to intraretinal changes, amount of retinal edema and thickening, and the most common example is diabetic retinopathy, and we all know that we can classify the diabetic patients now according to the foveal involvement or not, and if it is sensory detachment or not, and if it is a cyst in the fovea or not, and we can get a lot of data from this line scans. And what the most important thing to look when we have a diabetic patient like this, even after injection, even after resolution of this edema, these are the hyperreflective foci, which indicate the inflammatory origin of the disease. And second thing, destruction of this layer. This is the layers I was speaking about. The ISOS and external limbic membrane. If this patient is injected and with complete resolution of macular edema, you still have a bad prognosis in this patient. So you should tell the patient, you should consult the patient. You are going to be injected, you are going to be minimally improved, but at least you are not going to get worse in these cases. So we always look at these layers when we consult the patient, starting to inject the patient, to give him a prognosis before starting treating the patient. The pillars, if we lose these pillars, the molar fibers, it's a bad prognostic sign again, because these are the transmitting fibers. So OCT can give us a very important idea about the prognosis before start treating the patient. PVD or traction, is this a PVD or traction? Nowadays, there's a classification of vitreomacular interface abnormalities and traction. This is an abnormality. Why? This is a PVD, but with residual attachment to the fovea. Is this a contraindication for injection? No, it is not nowadays. But these are, because these are tangential traction and vitreomacular traction with a fibrous component, so we should not inject this patient, but we can inject this patient. At the vitreoretinal interface, the myopic traction maculopathy is a new entity, only can be seen by OCT because color fundus picture, fluorescein angiography cannot delineate what is going on with this traction maculopathy. So before we go into surgery, you have to understand that the vitreous sometimes has three layers. Look at this, look at this, look at this. If you remove two layers and you leave the third layer, you will have a recurrence after operation. Lastly, I will speak about, quickly, about optical coherence, tomography, angiography, which OCTA, and I had the chance to use this since 1.5 years in Egypt, and nowadays we are counting on a lot of clinical practice on OCT angiography. The principle is without injection of the dye, you can see the retinal and choroidal vessels. By what? By multiple line scans through the macula and then getting a signal of what is moving. The only thing is moving inside the retina is the red blood cells inside the vessels. So we can detect the movement of these red blood cells, we will detect the vessels. And I don't think the movie will work because it is not my computer. Anyhow, let me go to segmentation. The machine gets the signal, decorrelating the signal, and then give us four layers. The superficial capillaries, the deep capillaries, the level of retinal pigment epithelium where we don't see any vessels, and the level of the choroid capillaries. And automatically it is segmented, it is shown to you after the machine is getting the cue. What is the importance of OCT angiography? Without injection of any dye, without the hazard of the dye, we can see the central macular area. Like a patient like this with a diabetic retinopathy, we have all the data from the fluorescein angiography. Why we need OCT angiography? We can see the microaneurysm. Let's compare the 6 by 6 millimeter. We can see the ischemic area. We can see the ischemic area here. We can see the microaneurysm. We can see the same microaneurysm. We can see the Fez. We can see the Fez here. So it's almost comparable to fluorescein and even better resolution. So we can know, but is it functional? No, it's only structural. We don't know if there is edema here or not. We have to combine this with a line scan. And what is most important in OCT angiography, it gives you another layer, which we use not to see by fluorescein angiography, is the deep capillary plexus. And we will move in a minute to the branch vein occlusion, and it is very comparable, even much more crisp, clear picture by OCT angio. This is the fluorescein and OCT angio. You can get all the data, where the ischemic area is, where the collateral is, where the dilated vessel is, and the amount of ischemia. What's more, in the acute phase, sometimes the hemorrhage is obscuring the ischemic areas, but on OCT angio, you can know that this patient is ischemic and there is edema by the line scan. In the choroidal neovascular membrane, we can count now on OCT angiography by classifying the membrane if it's a type 1, so we see it above or below. It is below the retinal pigment epithelium, so it's better to see it at the level of choroid capillaries. But when it comes to type 2, the membrane penetrates the retinal pigment epithelium, it's under the retina, it's clearly seen at the level of RPE. Why? Because it's over the RPE, so it's clearly delineated and can tell if it is a type 1 or type 2. Can we tell it's active or not by OCT angiography? Yes. By the arborization, by the anastomosis, by the activity, by the flow through the vessels, so we can know this are active lesions. So how about the inactive lesion? The inactive lesion, decreased capillary density, we can see less capillaries, less anastomosis, and they call it dead tree appearance. It has a trunk without leaves. So it means this is a dead tree or inactive choroidal neovascular membrane. A new nomenclature coming in, which is flat, irregular RP detachment. It doesn't have to concern with the age. Sometimes it happens with young age, with old age, and they always have a silent CNV down there. And we use not to see this by fluorescein angiography because we used to diagnose as flat or irregular RP detachment or drusenoid RP detachment. And we didn't know this until OCT angiography that it is a CNV, a silent CNV down there. And it's commonly seen now in CSC. This patient had a recurrent attack. They always leak. They always have multiple points of leak. And when we look at the fluorescein and the OCT, we would see the fluorescein angiography multiple points of leak. We never expected to have a CNV. But when we look at the OCT angio, we can delineate a large choroidal neovascular membrane in a case of chronic CSC. And we have to watch out for this because some of these patients might be responding to injections, not to the usual methods of treatment. And some of these patients also might be, I'm sorry for this, but what is the limitation of OCT angio? Up till now, we have no much experience in this. It's limited experience. It can be used the same, not the same way of fluorescein. We don't see leakage. We don't see thickening, but we can see the ischemic areas. We can see what is going on with the vessels. It needs a learning curve, and sometimes the movement and distortion will destroy the image, and you will not be able to interpret this. But in the future, I think OCT angiography will replace fluorescein angiography in only one condition. If we have a wide field like this, which is coming in the market, wide field OCT angiography with color-coded flow inside the vessels. If the vessels here is hyper or has a high flow, it is in red. Less flow, it's in green, and minimal flow, which is in blue. So we can delineate the ischemic area in a wide field, and I think in the future it will help replacing fluorescein angiography. So basic knowledge is an important issue to digest recent technology, and OCT and OCTA is becoming an indispensable tool in the diagnosis and management of most vitreoretinal disorder, and mastering the basic in these things will help proper diagnosis and, of course, proper management of our patient. Thank you so much for your listening.